Assault rifles changed warfare, and with it, the world. With the introduction of the German STG-44 in World War II, and the subsequent proliferation of imitators and improved designs from major powers, gone were the days of infantry slugging it out at standoff range with big, full-power rifles that could shoot clear past the horizon. Portability, volume of fire, and low recoil became the order of the day, three traits that the assault rifle codified. They've been with us ever since, and today's militaries, mercenaries, rebels, and all other belligerents reach for these guns when diplomacy fails. In this video, we will be looking at five of the very best assault rifles in the world today. Before we dive into our list, we've got to clear something up because it's been bugging me. Increasingly, both online and off, I see more and more comments from folks getting wrapped around the axle concerning the precise definition of assault rifle and whether or not the term is even real or technically acceptable. The most egregious instance in this regard comes from folks who vent their spleens and try to shut down any mention of the term as somehow playing into the hands of anti-gun politicians and organizations. Invariably, this results from an awareness of the deliberate and malicious, but inappropriate labeling of semi-automatic rifles as assault rifles, an effort from anti-2A groups to demonize common rifles because of how they look. But these mental midgets overshoot the runway and would insist that educated people relabel genuine assault rifles as modern sporting rifles, an invented term trotted out to counter those efforts at civilian litigation. For those of you young guns who didn't live through the assault weapons ban of 1994, you might not know any better. Assault rifle is a real, historically used, technically accurate term for a specific category of small arms. It isn't a made-up boogeyman word, even though it is often misappropriated for such. An assault rifle is simply any intermediate caliber rifle capable of select fire and feeding from a detachable magazine, usually a detachable box magazine. That's it. Rifles capable of full auto that fire full power rifle cartridges, like 7.62 by 51 NATO, are not assault rifles. They are battle rifles capable of selective fire. Pedantic? Not at all, says me, and a lot of people smarter than me. With all that cleared up, we can get onto our list. Do note I will be using assault rifle in the correct context throughout this video, and I definitely don't want to hear anybody whining about it down in the comments. One of the most popular and beloved assault rifles, at least by video gamers, is the FN SCAR-L. The 5.56mm little brother to the SCAR-H, this short-stroke gas piston-operated rifle was one of the first U.S.-adopted next-generation assault rifles, ostensibly far more reliable than the legacy M4, and sporting a highly modular design to boot. Although adopted only in very limited numbers by U.S. SOCOM, the SCAR-L quickly earned a reputation for reliability, ruggedness, and ease of use in the Iraq and Afghanistan wars. It has also seen limited service in other conflicts, specifically the Russo-Ukrainian War, the Civil War in Yemen, and even the Mexican Drug War. With a polymer lower receiver and an aluminum upper receiver, the SCAR-L is very light, tipping the scales at just over 7.25 pounds. The reciprocating charging handle is easy to use for righties or lefties, but it has a nasty reputation for snagging on gear and terrain. Compared to most AR family rifles, the SCAR-L has a lower rate of fire, nominally around 650 rounds per minute. This should equate to better overall control when firing automatic, but these guns have extremely heavy, massive bolt carriers. They are jumpy and difficult to control, and they have a nasty tendency to break optics because of the immense G-forces involved during firing. Still, the extreme ruggedness and reliability evidenced by the SCAR-L have endeared it to many users. Though the larger SCAR-H has gone on to proliferate into multiple variants beyond a simple battle rifle, including a precision DMR variant, the sun is setting on the SCAR-L in U.S. military service, but it will likely stick around for some time in the form of a tiny PDW, the SCAR-SC. It's not quite out yet, but Beretta's new 5.56mm assault rifle is shaping up to be one of the best and most adaptable AR-inspired piston guns in military service. Called the NARP for now, short for New Assault Rifle Platform, I should note to viewers and listeners that this is the name of the program and not the final name of the rifle. It doesn't exactly have a nice ring to it. At any rate, while it outwardly looks almost identical to any number of M16 or M4 pattern rifles serving with militaries and agencies around the world, internally, the NARP is a very different beast. This short-stroke gas piston-operated gun is available with three barrel lengths for different mission profiles, including 11.5, 14.5, and 16 inches. The nominal weight is just 7.25 pounds, and with the stock collapsed, the overall length from muzzle to butt is just under 35 inches. The feature set is impressive and takes the almost perfect ergonomics of legacy AR pattern rifles. The mag release, bolt release, and safety are fully ambidextrous, and a forward assist is maintained on the right side of the gun. The assault rifle feeds from STANAG or Common Pattern AR magazines. The aluminum handguard features M-lock slots at 3, 6, and 9, and a full-length Picatinny rail stretching from up front over the gas block all the way to the rear of the receiver. Front suppressor, a design they claim will raise the bar for signature reduction and accordingly battlefield survivability for users. Naysayers might joke that Beretta is, once again, only 20 years too late. But despite the somewhat pedestrian appearance, I've got high hopes for the NARP. Beretta brought on board and consulted with seasoned members of elite forces at all phases of design, and I'm confident their new assault rifle will set a new standard for reliability and performance, even if it lacks the Italian panache and styling they are known for. We've got three more assault rifles to check out on our tour. Before we move on to the number 3 pick, take just 1 second to hit like and subscribe for me if you're enjoying the video. Those 2 clicks help us more than you know, and by doing so, you won't miss any of our upcoming videos. Thanks so much! Let me tell you, no list of the best assault rifles is complete without at least one AK variant on it. One of the best out there, and one that has been getting a lot of attention due to the war in Ukraine, is the AK-12M1. A product of Kalashnikov Concern, formerly Izhmash, this 5.45x39mm assault rifle has a cyclical rate of 700 rounds per minute and is capable of firing single shots or full auto, selectable through the use of the expected huge AK-style lever on the right side of the receiver. Previously, AK-12 pattern rifles also featured a 2-round burst setting, but this has been omitted going forward due to experiences with the gun in the Ukraine theater and elsewhere. What's most notable to Westerners about the AK-12 M1 is how ergonomic it is. The side-folding stock has 4 positions for adjustable length of pull, and a cheekpiece that allows better comfort and consistency with optics mounted. The iron sights are new compared to legacy AKs, with much improved ghost ring style aperture sights. A birdcage style flash hider can also accept a special sound suppressor for discreet use, and a lengthened handguard can mount accessories like vertical grips, lights, lasers, and more. For an AK, it is surprisingly light, weighing just 7.75 pounds empty, and in all regards, seems to be a thoroughly modern fighting rifle. Initial reports out of Ukraine and the Syrian civil war seem promising concerning the effectiveness of the AK-12 generally, but time will tell concerning its legacy compared to its massively influential ancestor. Love them or hate them, there is no denying that bullpups are just hanging on in the world of small arms. Every time someone declares them dead, one manufacturer or another will come out with a new design that will entrance military and agency customers, starting the whole argument over again. Whatever you might think about them as a concept, where the rubber meets the road is how any given bullpup performs on the battlefield. In this regard, the IWI Taver TAR 21 measures up quite favorably. This Israeli-produced 5.56 assault rifle has been around for quite a while now, in service with the Israeli military since 2001, and also finding adoption with many countries around the world, including Angola, Brazil, Colombia, Georgia, India, Mexico, the Philippines, Turkey, and most recently, Ukraine. Using now uncommon long-stroke gas piston operation, with the rate of fire between 750 and 950 rounds per minute, the TAVR, as it is commonly known, has proven itself to be reliable, reasonably accurate, and an excellent choice for close quarters use owing to its overall length of just 28 and a quarter inches. Designed from the ground up to be modular and adaptable, the ejection port can be configured for right or left side operation for ease of use with lefties or righties, and the fire selector, located immediately above the pistol grip, is also ambidextrous. Despite some early adoption hiccups and problems with sand getting into the chambers, the Char 21 has proven it can withstand the harshest desert environments and keep trucking, as Israel has proven over and over again. Despite the changing face of warfare, Israel is showing no signs of giving up on the TAVR, as evidenced by the adoption of the shorter X95 variant as their primary issue infantry rifle going into the future. Colloquially referred to as the Micro TAVR, this version features a much shorter barrel. It has been in service since 2009, though it suffered from a long design and iteration cycle beginning all the way back in 2003. Interestingly, the TAR-21 was being produced locally in Ukraine, under license for some time, chambered in 5.45mm. These rifles are, at press time, out of production. And the last rifle on our list is one of the newest, and currently the one on everyone's lips. The Sig Sauer XM7 is slated for adoption by the U.S. Army as the replacement for the M4. Chambering the 6.8x51mm intermediate cartridge and fitting from SR-25 pattern magazines, you'd be forgiven for mistaking the XM7 as a battle rifle. Soldiers toting this beast will be carrying a rifle that is significantly heavier than an M4 at nearly 8.5 pounds unloaded and bare, and giving up significant ammunition capacity and war load. Nonetheless, the 6.8x51mm cartridge, known commercially as the 277 Fury, is nominally classified as an intermediate round, and so the XM7 is an assault rifle, not a battle rifle. In any case, it is derived from SIG's MCX rifles, which are a sort of riff on the legacy AR operating system, one that does away with the receiver extension, spring, and buffer in lieu of relocating the mainspring to the receiver and relying on gas piston operation. Capable of semi-auto or full auto fire, the cartridge promises greatly improved power, flatter trajectory, and superb performance against next-generation body armor compared to the 5.56mm round. It is flat-shooting, hard-hitting, and relatively light-kicking. As of March this year, the XM7 is currently being fielded in limited numbers, and it forms the basis of a family of weapons, with the counterpart to the rifle being the XM250 light machine gun chambering the same cartridge. Will the XM7 prove to be an inspired choice for an infantry rifle moving forward into a new era of warfare, or another huge and costly DoD blunder? Time will tell on that part. And with that, we have come to the end of our list. The assault rifles we talked about today represent some of the very best and most influential in the world, and ones that will see action for decades to come. I really want to know what you think about the Army's new XM7. Do you think they made the right call moving away from a 5.56mm rifle? Or is this shaping up to be a major blunder for the average trooper? Let's talk about it down in the comments. And before you go, make sure to hit like and subscribe. That's all I've got for you today, but I will catch you soon in the next video. Stay safe out there!